हेलो एवरीबॉडी, वेलकम टू ट्रिपल आईटी एफसी कोहली मेमोरियल डे। सो वी हैव मेनी एक्साइटिंग डेमोस व्हिच वी आवर रिसर्चर्स हैव बीन डूइंग, फैकल्टी एंड स्टूडेंट्स। सो लाइक इमेजिन यू मूव फ्रॉम वन स्टेट टू अनदर स्टेट एंड यू डोंट नो द न्यू लैंग्वेज। कैन सम मशीन हेल्प यू टू ट्रांसलेट? एंड दैट्स हाउ वी विल स्टार्ट। सो इट्स माय प्लेजर टू इनवाइट गणेश टू to demonstrate how machines can help you in translating. Ganesh?
Yes, sir. Yeah. Good afternoon, one and all.
Please introduce yourself and start.
Good afternoon, one and all. I'm Ganesh Mirishkar, a full-time PhD scholar working with Dr. Anil Kumar Upala's Speech Processing Laboratory, IIIT Hyderabad. So I'll be starting my introduction by saying what all the works we've done in our research center. So in our research center, we primarily focus on developing speech-based solutions, which can make human interactions much more naturalistic as possible. So currently we are building a speech-based applications like speech recognition systems for Indian languages and speech-to-speech machine translation, speaker spoofing, language identification, emotion recognition, and we are also working on pathological speech processing. So today we will be showing few of our works which we have done so far. So firstly, we will be discussing about the speech recognition systems for Indian languages which we have developed. So as we know that India is a multilingual society with 22 official languages, where there is a huge need to build automatic speech recognition for these languages. So despite there are different orthographies, Indian languages share a common phonetic space. So there we have very minimal efforts in the research committee towards building an ASR systems for such languages. So we from IIIT have come up with different modeling techniques, with different pronunciation models. So one among them is a common label set. So and another practical problem is it would be very heavy to have 22 monolingual systems running parallelly. So what we have done is we have come up with a multilingual ASR systems for all these Indian languages. So what does a multilingual ASR system indicate here is there will be a single acoustic model, so such that all the languages will be recognized. So we from IIIT Hyderabad have come up with a unique framework for building such joint acoustic model using a common label set approach. So let me show you the interface what we have developed. I hope you can see my screen, right? Can anyone respond?
Yeah, we can see. Yeah.
Yeah, thank you. So let us test our interface. So we have built a multiple models. So let us test at first initially monolingual, then we'll be going for multilingual. So let me test for Hindi language. Mera Bharat Mahan. So let's listen this thing, right? Mera Bharat Mahan. So this is what an ASR does. So let me test for Telugu. Nenu Hyderabad lo unnanu. The same. This is the orthography, right? So let me test the same thing for multilingual system that indicates a joint acoustic model for these three languages. Here we have trained with Telugu, Tamil, and Gujarati. Podumokkal Mahati Anusar Nenu Ranu. Podumokkal Mahati Anusar Nenu Ranu. So this was one of the work which we have done. So next, what we have done is Can we translate this text into the another language? So we have come up with an application named it to be an IndiCAP, that is speech translation from one language to other languages. Greetings to one and all. We are from IndiCAP. The platform which we have developed predominantly focuses on Indian languages. As India being a multilingual society, there is a need for a platform or a tool where speech from one language is taken as an input and translates it to the target language. So the platform which we have developed is in line with speech-to-speech machine translation applications.
The interface which we have developed aims to bridge the gap between ASR community and machine translation community to have a multimodal speech translation for Indian languages. Internally, apart from web interface, the system mainly contains three modules. They are ASR engine, machine translation engine, and transliteration engine. ASR engine gets the text from a provided speech signal. Machine translation engine, which tries to translate the provided source language text into target language text. Transliteration engine is plugged into the interface as to edit the machine generated transcripts and translations if any human editing is required, either for ASR or machine translation generated outputs. The solution which we have developed enables the capability of speech to text translation from Hindi to English for four other Indian languages, namely Telugu, Marathi, Gujarati, and Punjabi. Now, let's have the look on the interface which we have developed. This interface is capable enough of picking audio as well as video as a source of input. So let's upload a sample audio file. Once the audio file is uploaded to the web server, it is sent for audio formatting. So the formatted output is sent to the ASR server to generate machine generated transcripts. So now let's have the look on the audio file which we have uploaded.
मैं जानना चाहता हूँ कि टच से बाहर कौन से स्टाइल का गाना है. दया सागर एपिसोड फिर से चलाओ. कौन है निर्देशक नायकों का. अगला एपिसोड चला दो माही वे का. आपका औसत आदमी नहीं कैसा है.
So you can see that the speaker has uttered a word touch in English, but machine couldn't recognize the word touch. Instead of that, it has generated taraf. So let's edit taraf to touch. So it has transliterated to touch. So now let's translate the source language, which is Hindi, to English. Right. It says, I want to know which style is the song outside the touch. So this interface is capable enough of translating to Telugu, Gujarati, Marathi, and Punjabi. Right. So this interface also provides an option to download the translation text. So let's have a look by uploading a video file. Let's listen to the video file.
ये नहीं सुलझाया गया तो इसका अंत सैन्य कार्रवाई से होगा. अब ऐसी स्थिति है कि लड़ाई बढ़ रही है और आसपास के देशों को भी अपनी चपेट में ले रही है. जैसा कि सुनने में आया है कि एरिट्रिया के सैनिक अब टिग्रिक क्षेत्र में हो रही लड़ाई में इथियोपियन सेना का साथ दे रहे हैं. ये एक गंभीर सैन्य संकट है जिसका मकसद है इथियोपिया की वर्तमान छवि को अपने मुताबिक बदलना और एक देश के तौर पर उसकी वो पहचान बनाना जो आपके हिसाब से मुफीद हो.
सो नाउ लेट्स ट्रांसलेट इट टू इंग्लिश. And the same thing to Telugu, Gujarati, Marathi, and Punjabi. So, such platforms makes meetings, conferences, and events accessible to non-native speakers with multilingual translations and improving comprehension and retention to them.
Yes, so this is what we have as of now. So if there are any queries, I'll be taking it.
Any questions for? I have one question.
Yes, sir. Yeah, sure.
Yeah. So. Can we develop I hear back in language which is my comfortable. Somebody speaking and I can hear immediately back in the language preferable to me.
Yes, sir. As of now, our dream application is the same thing, sir. If you speak in Hindi and probably if the guy he doesn't understand Hindi, he can translate and transliterate into the native language. That's our dream application. Yeah. We are still in progress, sir. We'll be trying to achieve it. Yeah.
Good. So it will be good if you have like mobile app in future which people can use.
Yes,
it
sir.
And just be really good. Any questions from audience? There is one question. Is it not real time provided if I am saying touch it print taraf?
It's not real time provided if I am saying touch it print taraf. Okay. So sir, we missed your audio, sir. I think. Okay. So actually, this interface first, whatever we speak, it has to be transcribed in one particular format, right? So the primary block of this application is an ASR block, right? So if the ASR is proper. If the ASR is proper, ASR means automatic speech recognition system. So what does it do is it will take the input speech waveform and convert it into corresponding text. If the ASR is proper, then only the other blocks will be proper. So probably there might be a chance where the error might be introduced due to the external factor. It can be anything. It can be the way the microphone is being recorded or the way we speak differently. Right. So that also affects with respect to our accents also. Hello?
Yes. Any more question?
Data used for ASR.
Yeah.
Okay. Actually, we have our in-house data, so which we have collected. And and you can say publicly available, we have just taken 40 hours of publicly available and rest all is in our in-house data which we have collected from our lab, from speech processing laboratory.
Okay, any more questions? I think if you have questions, you can actually contact Ganesh also. Speech lab should have their webpage. You can visit and contact these guys because we have to go on another demo also. So as I think this is a good, interesting demo, and I hope that we develop nice application which will be useful for us. So if we move from one state to another state, we really don't have to worry about language. So now we'll move on. Let's a little bit fly. So it's my pleasure to invite Harish from Robotics Center, where they build nice, interesting drones which can fly and take nice videos. So it's all over to Harish.
Hi, everyone. So I am Harish. I'm in my final year dual degree program at Robotic Research Center. So in RRC, we do a lot of stuff from autonomous navigation to, you know, complex tasks like localizing and obstacle avoidance and stuff like that. So today I'll be presenting the work which I've been working on over the past 3 years. Due to the interest of time, I'll just put on a recorded video and then later we can have this doubt session. So just let me know if you're able to see my screen. Is my screen visible? If anyone can confirm, that'll be great.
Yeah, we can see your screen.
Okay, Great. Hello all, I am Vaivyas Harish and I am going to present a popular area of research in the field of robotics called visual surveying. Precisely, I am going to concentrate on our recent works in deep visual surveying. I'll start with a brief introduction of what is visual surveying and move on to the pipeline as we go. Visual surveying addresses the problem of attaining a desired pose with respect to a given environment using image measurements from a vision sensor. Classical visual surveying approaches extract a set of handcrafted features from the images. Classical IVVS requires a coarse depth and use local appearance space features such as surf and shift to describe the scene, and the feature error is computed by difference between their locations in the current and the desired image. On the other hand, deep learning based approaches use dense feature extraction and mostly regress the relative camera pose between a pair of images. Moving on, following are the contents of our today's discussion. First, I introduce our first architecture, deep flow guided scene agnostic image based visual surveying. Next, we introduce our second architecture, deep model predictive control for visual surveying. In the third architecture, we show how we modify the previous approaches to perform real-time visual surveying. Now, we'll discuss our first architecture, DFVS, deep flow guided scene agnostic image-based visual surveying. In this paper, we present a visual surveying approach based on deep learning for attaining a 6DOF pose, which effectively generalizes to novel environments. We base our approach on image-based visual surveying. We use deep learning-based IVVS to compute the dense correspondence using an optical flow network. Our main contributions are summarized as follows. We propose a novel system consisting of deep neural networks that systematically integrates depth views with flow features. Our approach exhibits precision positioning even for distant goals, achieving convergence up to 4 meters and 40 degrees difference in pose, where existing approaches fail to converge. Our model also is able to generalize in diverse environments, both indoors and outdoors, effortlessly, without any need for fine-tuning or retraining, unlike other approaches. We present an extensive benchmark for deep surveying methods evaluating both precision and control performance on a variety of parameters such as photometric error, camera pose error, trajectory length, and convergence basin. We make our implementation and the pipeline to benchmark visual surveying approaches publicly available. It consists of photorealistic scenes classified into three categories as easy, medium, and hard based on the scene texture and convergence basin. It will help in facilitating fair and quantitative thorough comparison through various visual surveying approaches. Now coming to the pipeline, we employ a flow network to estimate dense correspondences between current view and desired view. That is, we use optical flow to estimate the feature error between the current and the desired image. For estimating the visual feature error, we use FlowNet2, which is state-of-the-art in flow computation. These visual features are easier to observe as compared to relative pose estimates. Furthermore, to capture the geometry of the scene, we pivot our approach on deep clues similar to classical image-based visual surveying. However, unlike classical IVVS, where a coarse depth is assumed, we are able to estimate the depth by using a deep network. As mentioned earlier, we employ FlowNet2 network to estimate the feature error between current and desired pose. To predict the scene's depth at a current pose, we propose two designs. The first one being single view depth estimation as seen on the screen. Our first design is based on directly estimating scene's depth from a single image. We employ an encoded decoder based convolution neural network to estimate the depth of the scene. Finally, we combine the cues from the depth and visual features using an interaction matrix similar to IVVS. The second proposed method is the two-view depth estimation. The depth network used in the previous pipeline can estimate the scene's depth from a single view. However, to achieve scene-agnostic depth prediction as an alternate, we propose to estimate the depth using an image pair, that is, the depth between IT and IT minus 1 as shown on the screen. Specifically, magnitude of the optical flow could be seen as an inverted scale representation of the underlying depth. We again rely on our flow network to compute the optical flow between current and previous image and use it as a proxy for depth, which allows the network to generalize across a diverse set of indoor and outdoor scenes. Finally, we again combine the cues from depth and visual features using an interaction matrix. This helps us in achieving a robust and precise visual surveying. The main motivation of the current work is to achieve an off-the-shelf scene-agnostic visual surveying. We test the proposed pipeline on Gibson dataset, which consists of photorealistic environments from Habitat Simulation Engine, as shown on the screen. To benchmark against existing deep visual surveying approaches, we perform simulation on 10 indoor photorealistic environments using Habitat Simulation Engine. It will help in facilitating fair and quantitatively thorough comparison of various visual surveying schemes. We have selected these scenes such that they cover different textures and variable number of objects. We classify these tasks in three categories. The first one being easy, as shown to your extreme left, and has more of this translational motion around 1.4 meters and a small rotation of 15 degrees between the initial and desired image. The second one being medium, in the middle of the screen, and has decent change in rotation, nearly 20 degrees and a translation of 1.5 meters. And the third one being hard, to your extreme right,
This has a huge amount of rotation greater than or equal to 30 degrees and a translation of greater than or equal to 2 meters. We now show some comparative results on simulation benchmark, scene 1. We can see that single view depth using depth network converges faster, the one in green, since it is able to predict the true depth of the scene. The second proposed pipeline, two view depth, also called flow depth, the one in black, is also able to converge, but due to proxy in place of actual depth in the interaction matrix, it takes more time to converge. Comparative results on simulation benchmark, scene 2. Similarly, here also we can see that our proposed pipelines converge in such a difficult setting as well. We now show a real-world experiment performed on Parrot Bebop 2 drone.
This was an experiment that was performed in the college itself, and this is the initial pose, this is the desired pose, and this is what the drone is seeing. So this is a third man view, and the drone was like, oh, it overwent and then it corrected itself and came back.
Moving on to the next architecture, we propose deep model predictive control for visual surveying. In this work, we propose a novel unsupervised deep model predictive control pipeline for visual surveying using optical flow as intermediate representation in 6 degrees of freedom. We learn the control actions in an unsupervised fashion as the LSTM decoder strives to predict the future control over a time horizon such that the optical flow acquired as a consequence of these predictions matches the desired flow. The desired flow between the current and the desired images is computed either through a supervised network FlowNet or an unsupervised framework DDFlow. We'll now explain our deep model predictive controller pipeline. The agent in the environment takes its current RGB sensor observation, previous observation, and the goal image as input. These images are passed through a flow encoder network that predicts the flow between the current observation and the previous observation, and the current observation and the goal image respectively, in order to obtain the desired optical flow. We use FlowNet 2.0 and DDFlow as our flow encoders. For the online control optimization, we use an LSTM as our recurrent network that takes in the previous control command and predicts an optimal sequence of current control commands. These predicted linear and angular velocities, along with depth from the optical flow, are fed into the kinetic model, which is the interaction matrix in our case. The kinetic model predicts a set of intermediate flows which are summed to get the final flow prediction. We finally optimize using the difference in target flow coming from the flow network and the flow generated using the predictive kinematic model using the flow loss, which is backpropagated through the online control optimization module. We now demonstrate comparative results on the benchmark scenes. We compare our approach of MPC plus LSTM with the baselines of CEM plus R predictive model and also NN with R predictive model. We also compare our results with DFVS, which is the current state of the art in visual surveying. The drone is able to correctly navigate to the desired location in this scene that includes two identical beds in the room. We plot the evolution of photometric error for comparing these approaches. It can be seen from the results that all the variants of our approach converge to the desired pose. While the neural network's photometric error initially decreases very quickly, it gets stuck into the local minima, whereas the CEM variant takes time to converge since CEM is a sampling-based approach. DFVS, on the other hand, requires a long time in order to reach the goal. Our LSTM variant approach converges fastest in comparison to the others. Navigation in this scene is difficult due to the large camera transformations and the presence of a large number of objects. Here again, all our variants are able to navigate to the goal image correctly in cluttered scenes as well. Here, we show some more comparative results of our controller in one of the benchmark scenes. Here also, it can be seen that our LSTM-based variant converges fastest to the goal image. The bar graphs showcase how our method strikes the most optimum balance between the number of iterations and the trajectory length. We substitute the flow encoder in our pipeline with an unsupervised flow network, DDFlow, which learns to predict optical flow given only the initial and the final image. The network is trained completely unsupervised on the Gibson environment using only the initial and the goal images. As it can be seen in the results, our controller is easily able to converge even when the flow is unsupervised, resulting in our entire deep model predictive control pipeline being completely unsupervised.
We now move towards our third architecture, wherein we propose a lightweight differential MPC framework for real-time visual surveying.
Deep MPC approaches to visual surveying generalize well to novel environments but are computationally expensive. Single-step methods greedily optimize and do not consider a time horizon. In this work, we propose a lightweight and a fast MPC framework that generates control in real time with the help of its slim architecture and effective sampling strategy. We can see that our method achieves a significant increase in the surveying rate as compared to the other approaches that optimize over a receding horizon. Our approach takes only 0.095 seconds per MPC step, which includes all overheads from the flow computation, and is around 10 times faster than all existing deep MPC approaches. While achieving this high surveying rate, our approach makes no compromise on the convergence criteria and attains a photometric error of strictly less than 500, as evident from the graph. Thank you.
Okay, so that's it from my end. So I can take any doubts if you have any.
Thanks, Harish.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah. So any questions? for Harish. Like, it was an interesting demo. We could fly and take interesting videos with the help of drones.
So you can contact me if you have any doubts later as well.
So there's a question that, will it work only indoor?
No, so the demo that we showed was actually of an outdoor thing, right? So we performed this in front of Himalaya. So if you want, I can show it again. But the thing that we showed was outdoor only. So if you see this here. Hello all, I am patient on 10 indoor. No time to converge. Yeah, so this demo was an outdoor demo.
Yeah.
Moving on to the next architecture, we prepare.
So how high does your drone can fly? Like how much height it can go?
So it depends on what kind of drone you're flying. So the drone that I used was Bebop. So that can go around like nearly 3.5 meters high.
Okay. So like suppose I want to survey a whole campus and like bit higher, will this technique develop, will work?
Yeah, definitely. So what we do is basically deploy our algorithms in the laptop itself and then use this robotic operating system called ROS to communicate with the drones. So if the flight time of the drone supports that and if it has enough power to reach those heights, then definitely we can do this. There are a few drones that have been self-built by our project interns and dual degree students and all in the lab itself. So we can definitely deploy these algorithms on that. Yeah.
Okay, good. So there's one more question from the Rao. He's asking reason to choose Habitat over other.
Pardon? Can you repeat?
The question is, can you explain the reason to choose Habitat over other?
Okay. So Habitat Simulator is basically, this has been provided by Facebook. So this can render complex 3D environments like Gibson data sets and other things as well. So one of the main reason was, its ability to render all these complex indoor and outdoor data sets. Yeah, that was the main reason to choose Habitat. We can definitely do these simulations in AI Thor or some other simulators as well. Yeah.
Any other question? So if there are no more questions, thanks Harish. He has flew us few meters above the ground. I hope next time he will flew us the whole of Hyderabad or like much higher, he will take us.
Yeah,
we are close to ground. So let's, my pleasure to invite Anis from CWEST, who have developed interesting sensors, which has many applications. So Anis, all over to you.
Thank you, sir. Good evening, everyone. I am Anis Fatima. I am working in CWEST Patriot Lab under the guidance of Dr. Aftab M. Hussain. I am pursuing my PhD. I'm in PhD second year. I'm working on a flexible pressure sensor mat, which we have made using, like, it's completely flexible, which is having a thickness of around only 300 micrometer. This flexible sensor mat can be used as an aid for physiotherapy. Like when patients are asked to do exercises as a part of their physiotherapy, there is no measure like how much are they improving in everyday life. Like today they have done this much part and next day. So like this pressure sensor mat will help them to perform exercises on this, and we can measure like how much they have improved in the doing the exercises, and how much is their recovery rate can be seen there. So I will also like to show the live demo of the map. Is the sensor mat seen? Can you see the sensor mat and the system with the heat map?
Yeah, Anis, we can see.
Yeah, thank you.
Just piece of paper.
Yeah, this is a piece of paper. This has a piezoresistive material named Velostat. It's like a sandwich structure. And this corresponding is the heat map here. And when I place a weight on a sensor, like this is a 4x4 pressure sensor matrix, we can see the corresponding weight on the heat map here. Like when I increase the weight, we can see that the voltage levels are increasing. So the patient can be asked to lift and place a weight on a particular sensor. And by seeing the output of the sensor, we can check if the person has placed in the correct position or he has placed in a different position. And we can also ask him to move the object along a particular line. And we can see from the output, like how he has moved the object around a correct line or not. So this is like one of the application. This is just a prototype. We have also our plan is to use this pressure sensor for a smart chair. Like this pressure sensor can be placed on a chair, on the seat and also on the back. And it can be used for posture recognition. Like if we are sitting on a correct position or we are leaning or bending, it can tell us by just recognizing the postures using the artificial intelligence algorithms and all. And as of now, like we can also tell like how much time the person is requiring to move the object and how much weight is he applying on that. And we can monitor his recovery rate, like how is he improving in performing the exercises. So I'll just share my screen and give more explanation on that.
Your audio is not available, Anis.
Before sharing, you have to select share audio.
While sharing the script, you need to say include your system audio. It will be somewhere button.
Okay, sir.
Share computer sound is the button at bottom side left.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Got it.
Okay.
Hello everyone. Now is it audible? I'm working in the US Patriot Lab. I'm pursuing my PhD under the guidance of Dr. Aftab M. Hussain. I'm working on a flexible pressure sensor array which we made using paper as a structural material. This is a 4x4 pressure sensor matrix which is fabricated such that a piezoresistive material named Velostat is sandwiched between two papers on which the copper tapes are attached. These copper electrodes form a crossbar architecture with the Velostat layer as the active pressure sensing layer. The copper electrodes were of 1 cm width separated by a pitch of 6 cm. Thus, the individual sensor pixel is of size 1 cm by 1 cm. Here, each number represents one sensor pixel. The total thickness of the pressure sensor matrix is approximately 300 micrometer, which makes it highly flexible. The cables are soldered onto the copper tapes and are connected to the microcontroller, and all the sides of the pressure sensor were sealed with a scotch tape. The working principle is based on the piezoresistive effect of the polymer composite Velostat. Now we can see that when I place a load on a sensor pixel, for example on sensor number 10, the corresponding change in the voltage can be seen on the heat map. And as I apply more pressure, the voltage reading increases. Now I am moving this along the sensor mat. You can see the corresponding changes on the heat map. The pressure sensor matrix can be used for recognizing activity and assessing the performance of stroke patients by letting them performing exercises on the sensor mat as a part of their physiotherapy. In most cases, the stroke patients are asked to lift and place a weight on a designated area. For example, if we ask the person to place the sensor on sensor number to place the load on sensor number 6, then by checking the output of the sensor 6 and the peripheral sensors, we can detect if the load was placed on a accurately on a correct position or not. Exercises can also be performed and assessed in which the person can be asked to move the object along a given line on the sensor. And by checking the output of the sensors, we can see if the person has dragged the object along a correct line or not. Analyze these results, we have used neural network to monitor the response and recovery of the patients. We have used neural network since it is easy, simple to use, and it learns by itself. By giving the coordinates of the load to the neural network, it helps us to determine the correct position of the load. It can also learn from the responses of the person over a period of time. Thank you.
So that was it. Like we have also performed all the static and dynamic characteristics of the sensor, like how much sensitivity it can handle, how much weight, till how much weight it can show the pressure values, and all the characteristics have been analyzed. And we are planning to use it in smart chairs and also for other applications that can be useful for people. Thank you. That's it from my side.
Thank you, Anis. Any questions from audience? So I have one question. Can you develop this? Your so interesting. You have converted paper into sensor with small connections. Can we make a notebook which I write here and all of it can record me in my computer using these sensors?
Yes, sir, sure, we can do that. Like, we can also make a flexible notepad using that, but just by increasing the matrix. Like, I have made only a 4x4, we can increase it to like a 40x40 matrix, and it can be used as a notepad. Like, we can sense it. So we can do that using just a paper and sensors.
Yeah. Good. And how, like, sir, can we use this to measure weights? Like,
yes, sir. Now it is able to measure weights till 10 kgs. So we can use for that also.
I want to ask, but I could see that you just move and it was so nicely moving here, that heat map. How small unit you can measure?
We can measure it till 50 grams. From 50 grams till 10 kgs.
Oh, yes. That's quite good. So because most of the weighing machines we see have normal weighing machines have at least 100 gram accuracy. Commercial grade are different. We have plus minus 4 gram, but normal weighing machines have 100 gram, and most of the one which are available at reasonable price are 400 gram. So if your accuracy is 50 gram, it's quite interesting.
Yes, thank you.
So any questions from audience? If no more questions, let's thank Anis, and let me invite Animesh from our science department who are building future computers. They let him take us to how quantum computers building will happen. So some of the aspects of quantum circuit building. So Animesh.
Hello.
So just
good evening, sir. Okay, so I hope you can see my video feed. I'm not sure. I'm Animesh, and I'm a third year undergraduate at CCNSB, Center for Computational Natural Sciences and Bioinformatics. I have been working on quantum circuit transformations using reinforcement learning under Professor Harjinder Singh and with my senior Utkarsh. We have been working on a purely machine learning project to make our compilation of quantum circuits better, so that we can run larger and larger circuits in this NISQ era of quantum computing where we do not have long-term coherence. So I'll try to show you a live demo here, but let's start off with the video. Have I shared sound? I'm sorry. Can you hear the sound?
No, I'm not able to hear. So while sharing, when you click on share button, at bottom left, there will be button like share computer sound. If you do that, it will work.
So there is no button. There is share your screen and there is your entire screen.
No, the screen and then bottom left in that window, the checkbox, share computer sound.
So I don't see a checkbox. I'm on the web app, not on the local desktop app. So can you please share the YouTube link or
the video. Let me play your video. How your video?
Hello everyone, and welcome to our project on quantum circuit transformations using reinforcement learning.
So our audience able to hear the voice?
Well, it looks very much like a classical circuit with a bunch of qubits starting out, participating in one qubit operations, which are analogous to NOT gates, and multi-qubit operations, which are analogous to AND gates. Or the difference, however, is that due to the no cloning theorem of quantum mechanics, the states cannot be copied from the memory, operated upon, and brought back. Therefore, the CPU has to be built on top of the memory itself. So all qubit operations are not possible. Two qubit operations can only be applied to qubits which are physically neighboring each other. In this example hardware topology here, 2 and 5, 2 and 4, 3 and 4, etc. can be operated on, but 2 and 7 is an invalid operation since it's not local. Here we take the example of trying to compile down to this target hardware with 0 at the center. The initial circuit does not respect the constraints of this target hardware by having an operation on qubit 1 and qubit 2, which is not local on the target hardware. We can convert this circuit into an output circuit by adding in swap gates, which converts this into a valid operation, but makes the circuit a little bit deeper. We are tasked with devising an algorithm which takes an input circuit and converts it into one which faithfully respects the constraints of the target hardware while adding the minimum possible depth in terms of the number of added swap operations possible. To represent our problem to the reinforcement learning agent, we take our input quantum circuit and convert it into a directed acyclic graph of dependencies. Each 2-qubit operation is a node in our graph, and 2 nodes are connected by an edge or a dependency if and only if they share at least one of their 2 qubits. Our model will start at the leaf nodes, schedule them on the target hardware, and pop them from the graph, and then keep on making its way iteratively through the rest of the graph. The evolution of state from the perspective of the agent is shown in this image. Here we show that the agent is scheduling several operations. The yellow and orange colors are used for CNOT operations, whereas the green and the purple colors are used for the swap operations, and you can see that the agent evolves the state until it completes the set of tasks that it was assigned in 5 time steps. Since we want to minimize the total depth of the circuit and not just the number of operations, we need to build the idea of parallelization into our model. At the same time step, different pairs of qubits can parallelly enter different operations, but no two operations can share the same qubits. This is what makes our tasks different from games like chess. Chess has on average 35 moves at any time step. Go has 200, but our problem has over 2 to the power 16 operations we get to choose from. Other research attempts, scanty as they are, propose using a simulated annealer to search through the action space, which is guided by a deep Q network where a bunch of linear neural layers parameterize the system. We propose to replace this with a Monte Carlo tree search, which is guided by a graph neural network. To solve the problem of searching in a combinatorial action space, we perform our Monte Carlo tree search in 2 stages. In the first stage, we take our default solution and one by one in an autoregressive manner set up different swaps into the solution. And finally, once we are done with this, we break out into the second stage, committing our operation, which was built up as a combination of individual moves, into the composite set of swaps and CNOTs that needs to be performed into the time step and update to the next state. Like all MCTS searches, we select a leaf node, we expand it out to the next state, we get our model to evaluate it, and then we finally back the values that we have learned from this update up into all of the parents of the node and train our neural network based on it. This method has obviously been inspired by the success of the same idea being used by DeepMind's AlphaZero, amongst others. We use standard Bellman updates to update our value function and policy functions, together with a special form of upper confidence bound on trees, which is made specifically for asymmetric trees. we have a graph neural network to evaluate the value function, or how good a given state is. We take our state representation and put it through an EdgeConf block, followed by a few concatenations and other dense layers. We use switch activations in our network since they perform better and computational costs are not a primary bottleneck in our model. Let's take a look at how we visualize the agent as it works through the graph, trying to improve it to at least human level accuracy. The green boxes represent the swap operations, whereas the blue boxes represent the two-qubit operations. We constantly keep on seeing the reward function that is being shown on the right-hand side of this first image, as well as the next targets, or in the 4x4 qubit case, the number of operations that have completed. And this is the primary visualizer that we use to validate correctness of our model. The primary value proposition for our method comes from the following facts. We present the idea of using mutex locks in RL agents to represent the state of parallelization to the environment and to the neural network. This helps us deal with slower gates like swap gates, which are 3 times as slow as other gates, by making the mutex locks integer valued. We also use a better representation method, providing more information about the state to a graph neural network, which exploits the fact that several of these parallelization decisions are local to a subpart of the graph. We hope to extend this in the future by using transformers for improving our long-term planning, but that's a little too expensive to train right now. Finally, the autoregressive setting provided by Monte Carlo Research leads to much stabler training and more guaranteeable results. We are very optimistic about the results of our method, since we have the best performance of all frameworks on IBM's Large Circuit Realistic Test dataset, and the third best performance on Random Circuits dataset. But this is expected, since our neural networks have a hard time strategizing for random gates, and the two methods which do better than us on this dataset are explicitly made for working well on perfectly random datasets. Finally, we are attempting to package all of this into publishable work very soon, and hopefully within the week we'll be able to offer this for download from our GitHub page and on pip by the name QRoute. We also hope CTS step is done, etc. If you are interested in this work or have comments, please feel free to get in touch with us on animesh.sena@research.iit.ac.in. Thanks a lot for your time. It was a pleasure presenting to you. Thank you.
Yeah, any questions from audience? So Animesh, with this, you know, this very interesting your demonstration that you are using machine learning technique to build new quantum circuits. So how soon we can expect to build quantum computers?
We already have quantum computers. We have up to 50 to 60 qubit quantum computers. But the quantum advantage, like we see some algorithms being slightly better, but an exponential advantage is still an unknown time off right now, sadly. So, yeah.
Okay, good. Hope your techniques are helpful in building bigger quantum computers and world changes for better.
Thanks a lot.
Any questions from audience? So as we are talking about future where quantum computers be a reality, let's be in future with some virtual reality. And it's my pleasure to invite Raghav to take us through virtual world. So Raghav, all yours.
Thank you, Professor Sujit. Hi all, my name is Raghav Mittal. I am a MS by research student at IIIT Hyderabad. I work at a Software Engineering Research Center. So at our center, we are working on various projects related to virtual reality, from building custom HMD to developing novel locomotion techniques in room scale virtual reality. So I'm going to present one of the techniques which we have developed for locomotion in room scale virtual reality.
Good evening. My name is Raghav Mittal. I am a MS by Research student at Software Engineering Research Center, IIIT Hyderabad. My area of research is human-computer interaction in virtual reality. Generally, there are three types of VR headsets: phone-based, like Google Cardboard, Samsung Gear VR, which when combined with a mobile phone become a fully functional VR headset. Standalone VR headsets like Oculus Quest come loaded with all the resources necessary for running VR apps. PC VR headsets like Oculus Rift, HTC Vive require a workstation to function. One of the major difference between their capabilities is in their ability to track users' movement. In general, phone-based VR can only track head movements, which means you cannot walk physically inside the environment. On the other hand, many standalone VR and PC VR devices have the capability to track the user's position in the space in addition to head movements, which allows the users to walk physically inside the virtual environment. This kind of tracking is called 6DOF tracking. While walking in a virtual environment, wearing a headset, one has to be very cautious about the physical boundaries or walls of the room where the VR is set up. Not doing so may lead to accidents and injuries due to hitting the wall. Also, exploring the virtual environments, which are larger than the physical space, is difficult. Due to these reasons, continuous and unbounded natural walking in VR is challenging. We have developed a solution for this problem. It's a path generation system which generates a path such that when user follows the path, they perceive the physical environment as unbounded and limitless. There are existing solutions as well, but those either require specialized hardware or high computing resources. Our approach is software oriented. Our solution doesn't require any specialized hardware and consumes fewer resources. As a use case, we have developed an art gallery. As you can see in the simulation, the blue colored cylinder is the user exploring the environment. As the user walks further, the path is updated and the gallery is rendered in a way that user perceives it as limitless. As I walk in the forward direction, the environment is generated dynamically and images are placed on the walls. Currently, we are working on improving our algorithm to give a more immersive experience to the user. I would like to thank my thesis advisor, Dr. Raghu Reddy, for guiding and mentoring me. I would like to thank our co-author, Mr. Sai Anirudh Karre, for his contributions. And I would like to thank my lab mates for their inputs and support. Thank you, everyone.
Any questions from audience? Thanks, Raghav, for taking us in this virtual world. It was very nice, interesting to see that what is what you are doing these days. So if there are no more questions, let's come back from virtual world to a little bit reality.
Thank you.
And let's invite Ayush and his colleagues to demonstrate how they are building smart cities and IoT-based devices. So it's all over to Ayush.
Thank you, Professor Sujit. Hello, everyone. I am Ayush Kumar Devedi. I am a PhD scholar at Signal Processing and Communications Research Center at IIIT. I work under the guidance of Dr. Sachin Chaudhary. So at SPCRC, we work on different aspects of next generation wireless communication, like information theory, channel coding, multiple antenna systems, compressive sensing, and IoT. Today, I'm going to present you one of the applications and the device that we have built in the field of IoT for a smart city application. Let me take you through the demo video first, and later we can have more discussion about this device. I'll share my screen. I hope the video will play now.
Thank you.
Air pollution is one of the biggest problems we are facing, but we are unknowingly ignoring it. Although we are having the air quality monitoring system in the city, but they are bulky, they are costly, and they are not also dense deployed, due to which we are not getting the localized data. Due to these issues, we are motivated.
At IIIT, we have developed portable air quality monitoring devices which are suitable for dense deployment. The controller and sensors are enclosed inside the IP65 waterproof box. This device measures particulate matter of size 2.5 and 10 microns. This particulate matter arises in the atmosphere from automobiles, industries, and construction activities. The device uses PM sensor, which works on the principle of laser scattering. It uses a small fan to draw the air inside and uses the scattering phenomena to get the particle concentration. It is also having a temperature and humidity sensor. It is backed with lithium-ion battery that offers around 1 day of battery backup. The device also has a GPS sensor such that it can be used for mobile measurements. Since it is very low power, it can be easily plugged into the 12-volt battery outlet of cars. With the help of PM 2.5 and PM 10, the air quality index is calculated and displayed on the web-based dashboard for public view.
In the first phase of development, prototype devices were deployed at IIITH campus. Locations inside the campus were selected such that all the different social activities are covered. The prototype device had NOVA SDS-011 dust sensor and DHT-22 temperature and humidity sensor interfaced with a Wi-Fi enabled microcontroller. It made use of a commercial Wi-Fi hotspot and was powered with a lithium-ion power bank. The NodeMCU microcontroller samples data from the sensors and transmits it periodically to ThingSpeak, which is a cloud-based IoT platform for storing and processing data using MATLAB. NodeMCU uses on-chip ESP8266 module to connect to available Wi-Fi access points for sending data at a sampling rate of 15 seconds. Having gained experience from in-campus deployment, in the second phase, we improvised to develop a robust and compact device with additional features for deployment outside the campus. The prototype had dependency on the Wi-Fi access point, so we integrated an eSIM, which is a multi-network remote updatable embedded SIM tailor-made for low data IoT or M2M applications. These nodes are deployed in an area of 4 km by 4 km at Gachibowli in Hyderabad, which is a corporate district home to business parks with tech company offices, as well as campuses for the educational institutes. The locations were strategically selected after performing a geospatial analysis of this area. Special care has been taken such that different land use environments like urban, semi-urban, and green areas are covered. We also collaborated with Society for Cyberabad Security Council to deploy 15 nodes on CCTV camera poles at major junctions and streets of selected area. The sensors used in building this node are low-cost sensors. To achieve higher performance of low-cost sensors, we calibrate them using collocation-based technique, where the low-cost sensors are collocated with the high-precision device and the data is collected. On the collected data, we apply machine learning algorithms such as linear regression and random forest regression to understand the bias between the low-cost sensor and the high-precision device. This kind of calibration is done in multiple iterations, initially in the lab environment and later in the field environment as well.
A web-based open access dashboard has been developed to show the sensor network data in real time, as well as the historical trends for all the devices. This dashboard can be accessed at spcrc.iiit.ac.in/air. It provides an easy graphical interface for the administrator to manage the network in terms of adding or removing a device or giving access to a guest user with predefined access rights. The dashboard uses a secure Django framework at the backend, and makes use of tokens to verify any API request.
This project would have impact in terms of improving the quality of life and making urban planning more efficient. Making the data public will increase community participation as well.
Thank you everyone for your time. I can take questions if anyone wants to know more about this device and the project.
Any questions from the audience? So I have some quick question. Where all you can use this device? Is it just air pollution or you have many other applications where you can use these devices which you are building?
So right now, the scope of this device is limited to measure the quality of air because it has sensors which can sense the concentrations of particulate matters. In future, we also intend to interface a couple of gas sensors which are harmful and usually pollute the air. We also are planning to integrate a couple of sound sensors such that we can also measure the sound pollution. So yeah, that is how the scope of this device is defined.
And are you planning to build any other such devices which will be useful for smart cities and like IoT based devices? Are you?
Of course. So this particular effort lies in the under the larger umbrella of smart city project which we are doing at IIIT, where we have verticals in different domains. We are also working in the domain of water management, in the domain of solar power management, as well as crowd monitoring. So in future, you'll see multiple solutions coming up for all these verticals, and we'll probably have specialized devices for them as well.
Any more questions from audience? If no more question, I think there's one question. Let me see it. Cost of device is what is the question Arav is asking.
So yeah, interesting question, because we are at a phase where the device is still under development and under R&D, but I can assure you that the cost of this device is much lesser than any other device which you get in the commercial market these days, which can do something similar to this. But yeah, because still it is an R&D project, it will not be correct for me to quote any number here.
Okay, but any estimate, like not like current cost, but if suppose this goes in mass production,
we have heavily cut down. I can assure you, we have heavily cut down on the cost of the device.
Currently available devices, similar devices. What are
so currently, if you see a device which can do something similar to this one, costs around 25-30K to up to 40K in Indian commercial market. We are very sure we'll be somewhere half of what it's available right now.
Yeah, that will be really good. Yeah. Because if you want to deploy in large scale,
correct,
50% will be really huge amount. And I wish you could do further better than 50% reduction. So
sure.
It's been very interesting. We are building smart cities, and if your smart city is virtual reality, let's have some entertainment from how AI can entertain us and help in building better entertainment tools. So it's my pleasure to invite Bhanu to walk through us some of their work. Bhanu, all yours.
Thank you, Sujit sir. So I am K.L. Bhanu Murthy, a PhD student under Dr. Vinit Kanti, and I'm from CVIT. At CVIT, we...
Bhanu, is it possible to little bit go closer to your mic? I am not able to hear you that clearly.
Okay. Hello, am I audible now? Is it better? Hello. Hello.
I can hear what I'm actually hearing, at least. If others are hearing fine, I'm fine.
No, I'm not able to hear very clearly. So I also wanted to ask Sujit, which present, how many are, I mean...
this is the last one.
Last one, okay. Others went through fine, I hope.
Yeah.
Is it better now?
Yeah, this is a bit better.
Yeah, okay, thank you. So I'm Gail Bhanamurthy, PhD student with Dr. Vineet Gandhi. I work in CVIT, where we try to develop systems which basically understand how computers perceive the world and try to develop applications on that. And the aim of my research is creation of intelligent systems to aid content.
Banu, sorry to disturb you, interrupt you. Can you please speak a bit louder?
Yeah, sure. I'll try that.
Sometimes if you remove your headset, things may work better. Why don't you try that?
I think directly use the system audio and system.
Yeah.
So sometimes these headsets may not work well.
Hello, am I audible better?
Yeah, now we can hear you well. Good. Go ahead.
There's probably some issues. I'm going to start again. Sorry for this technical delays. I'm KL Bhanumurthy, a PhD student with Dr. Vineet Gandhi, and I work in CVIT. And the aim of my research is creation of intelligent systems to aid content creation. So in the past few years, we have seen the consumption of YouTube videos and et cetera, has skyrocketed very much. But the amount of content creators is still low because content creation is still hard. Professional video creation is quite hard. So my aim is to create such systems so that even a layman can create videos in a very easy way. So ideally, if my friend comes to me with a drama script, say for example, and asks me to help him with creating a video for that, the intelligent system would be able to tell him how to place cameras wherever to record it, take the recordings, and then stitch them together in a coherent narrative to get a good edit, good storyline out of his script. So that would be the ideal system. And these systems which we have developed use the recorded videos and try to edit them automatically. So let me show you a video about our recent work. Is my screen visible?
Yes, we can see your screen.
We present to you Gazed, a gaze-guided cinematic editing of wide-angle monocular video recordings. Stage performances are usually captured using a static camera owing to restricted viewpoints, no option for retakes, and exorbitant cost for multi-camera setup. Such static visualizations are apt for archival purposes, but they often fail to keep the audience captivated. We use the static video along with its corresponding gaze of a few users to create an edited video. Eye gaze is used as a cue to capture interesting scene content, we employ viewer's gaze as a proxy to select shots for inclusion in the edited video.
Hello, ladies. God damn it. Fiona? What are you doing here? Can't you tell we're trying to have a conversation?
Well, I heard you have a little crush on Damus.
What? Where did you hear that?
I have my sources. And I also have a little news, and you're not going to like it very much.
The method first simulates multiple virtual pan-tilt zoom cameras by moving cropping windows inside the master shot.
That is a desperately sick lot.
Why, don't you know it even yet? My arm has gotten tired of whipping you.
You're mad.
For 23 years.
You're deluded, mother.
A discrete optimization is used for shot selection.
Deluded.
Oh, it's not what I wanted, believe me.
You're sick.
I'll show you who's sick. Boy, you're really having a field day of it, aren't you? Well, I'm gonna finish you. When I'm through with you...
You and your quarterback, you're gonna finish me. Well, you're gonna wish you never mentioned our son.
Here is one example of an edited video of a music concert.
Well, you're very kind. Thank you.
Low key for what I usually do, but I love good songs. Here's a particularly good song by Rodney Crowell. Let me introduce the band here. This is JT Thomas here on the keyboards. And on the bass guitar, Will McGregor. Very lucky to have these.
Computational efficiency of our algorithm allows for interactive content exploration. Here is one example with different cutting rhythms.
Oh! J'ai fait 500 à Providence et 700 à Boston.
C'est vrai?
We performed an extensive user study comparing our method with four competent baselines. Gazed outperformed them in terms of narrative effectiveness, conveying scene actions, capturing actor emotions, and overall viewing experience. Comparison videos can be found in the supplementary material.
That was our recent work, and we are currently working on methods to improve the narrative by deciding, you know, what is more interesting in a video, what else can we do. We are exploring such ways to improve our editing. So I would like to take some questions if you have any.
Thank you, Banu. Any questions from audience? So Arava has a question, what is the data set you have used and what is the accuracy on your test?
So this is not a neural network model, and the data set we used was created by us. So we curated a lot of videos which were statically recorded from one camera, and then we used them to create our edited videos, and along with we devised few competent baselines and then compared the results with them.
Okay. Any more questions from audience? So I have one quick question for you, Banu. Is it like real time? Like if I have watching some movie instead of watching movie online, which is recorded, say with a single camera, can you display me the movie with nice focusing, which you guys are doing?
Yes, actually. So the bottleneck is not actually our algorithm. And so the previous pre-processing steps might be some of the bottlenecks, but our algorithm sure is real time. So for it has about a one frame latency. So we can definitely do editing in real time.
Okay, this is one question from audience again. How are you measuring your error in gauge?
How are you measuring error in gauge? We're not exactly measuring the error in gauge. So the shots we pick, we kind of measure the distances from each of the shots center to the gaze points to get this potential. So it doesn't matter wherever these gaze points are. We compute based on their position, the potential, the importance of which shots to be shown. That is how we are trying to do this.
Any more question? Use case in real life.
Yeah, so editing is a very long process. So for directors, even for smaller production teams, you have to sieve through hours and hours of feed to just get to something called rough cut. So what happens is they take a lot of videos, stage them together. That's called a rough cut. Even editing has a lot more steps, but creating the rough cut itself for say about an hour of a video, it takes about 18 to 20 hours. So using our method, you can quickly create a lot of rough cuts and creatively explore a lot of different edits. So that's going to help novice editors a lot while creating some good videos. So it has a lot of applications.
Yeah, I can see that is very interesting. So in terms of time, I think we should conclude this session. So I would like to thank all the participants, all the audience, as well as analysts who walk us through these interesting demos. Like they have shown that if you throw paper at them, they will make converted into sensors. They have shown how they can build smart cities with a lot cheap of economical devices. They are building IoT based devices. They are building future quantum computers. They are building virtual reality. And how if you move from one state to another state, the language should not be a barrier. So they are developing automated tools, even speech based tools. So it was all overall interesting demos. And I would like to thank everybody. And if you have any questions, further questions, we can always contact them. And it's time to say bye. Soon we will start with advisor alumni discussion in 10 minutes time. Okay then, bye everybody.